the Lord and He answered me and delivered me from every fear. Those who look on Him are radiant, they'll never be ashamed, they'll never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard me and saved me from my enemies. The Son of God surrounds His saints. He will deliver them. He will deliver them.
Tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, brokenness and pain is all I know. I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in Your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in Your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in Your love.
not a captive to lies. And I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken.
My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Well, let's sing verse 2 again. Shame no longer has a place. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to the lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken.
My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Oh, there's power, power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty our grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name, power in your name. Oh, there's power that can break off every chain.
There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name.
Oh, come on, let's praise him. Come on, let's bring him praise this morning. Hallelujah, Lord. We're so grateful that fear doesn't stand a chance, God, when you're around us. God, we don't have to be afraid of anything. We can walk in the power and the might of your power in us, oh God, the Holy Spirit working in us and through us. Oh, Lord Jesus, I just thank you this morning. I thank you for your power that's in this place, God, to bring healing, to bring restoration, God, to make people be able to know you, Lord God, to have that ability to understand who you are, God, in a greater way. Lord, we just thank you this morning for the power of your Holy Spirit that's working right now, right here in this place. Hallelujah. Can we give him praise once again, Lord? Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated this morning. So good to have all of you here in the house today and all of you online as well. We're just so glad to have you with us in service today. It's going to be a great day. Today is Women's Ministry Day. Yeah. Hallelujah. We love the ladies of this church and all that they mean to us in ministry and what they do for just ministering in so many different ways. And so we're just glad to honor you today and just have this service to be in your honor. Hallelujah. Just a couple of announcements. Today we have, this afternoon, we're going to have our annual business meeting. And so we want you to come and be a part of that. The church will be providing a meal today, cooked by the Humburgers. And so it's going to be awesome. And at 5 o'clock, we're going to have dinner. And then approximately 6 o'clock or maybe a little before, we're going to try to go right into the business meeting. So we do have childcare. If you need childcare to come, please see Pastor Madeline. Let her know that you're going to have children coming. Now, this is only elementary age and below, okay? So not the older kids. They can hang out at the house, okay? But anyway, we just want to have the child care for the younger ones. But we're also going to provide this on Zoom. So if, for those who are not able to attend in person, we want you to know that we've sent out another email reminder just this morning about the Zoom that you can sign into. Pastor Pete will be monitoring it, and we'll share the reports on the screen as well, but we send out in that email the reports so that you can have them on your phone or on your tablet or on your computer at home, and you can look at those or you can print them out at your leisure at home. We want to make sure that everyone has the information. So the Zoom, the way it will work is that if you're on Zoom, you can, you know, listen in and everything. You won't be able to speak, but you can chat, okay? So down at the bottom, there's a little thing to chat, and you can type in a message. So if you have a question, you just type in the message, and Pastor Pete will get that and bring it in to the meeting. And so that's the only way we can do it, because we have to have everyone physically present to be able to vote. So they won't be able to vote if they're online, but you will be able to participate by giving questions and having your answers, you know, given on the Zoom. So we want you to make sure, check, you know, some people with the emails, sometimes it's going to junk mail. I don't know why you've got Grace Point set up as junk mail. No, I'm just kidding. I don't know, but it happens, okay? So if you didn't get your email, check that and make sure that it didn't go there somehow by accident, I'm sure, okay? We want to make sure that everybody has the information and everybody can be a part of the annual business meeting. It's going to be a great report, and you won't want to miss it. So be here 5 o'clock tonight down in the fellowship hall is where we'll be meeting. Also, please don't forget that we are providing snacks for the sheriff's office. Pastor Pete shared a little bit about this last week, where we're getting snacks and taking them to the sheriff's office so that they have them like in a pantry. So, like the officers can go in there and grab a few, you know, things, some crackers and some stuff like that to put in their car, because many times they'll get called out and be on a call and miss dinner, you know, and so they need something to just, you know, get them by, and so we want to do that and provide for that. If you want to help by financially supporting that, you can just put sheriff's office or sheriff's on there on your tithe envelope or on your check memo or whatever you want to do to let us know that goes to the sheriff's snacks that we're going to be providing them. And if you want to participate in helping and going and delivering those, we'd love to have you be a part of that as well, to build those relationships with our sheriff's department. Amen? Because we love them, and we back the blue, right? That's right. And so we want to make sure that they know that we support them and love them. Just as far as, you know, tithing and giving, I just wanted to make mention once again. I don't mention this very often because, you know, I think we've gotten kind of in a rhythm of this, but just want to make sure everybody knows that there are different ways that you can give right now during this pandemic setting. We're just not passing the bag or the plate to put your offering in, but we do have the box out in the front, so you just fill out your check. There's the envelopes should be in the backs of the chairs or out on the table. And you just fill that out, put it in the box that's provided for in the foyer there. Or you can do it online. We have online giving at our website. That's at gphickson.com. And so you can go there and give online. Or you can set it up with your bank to have it mailed in. Many are doing that. Or you can mail a check in an envelope. And many are doing that as well. So we just want you to know that we're trying our best to provide that for you, every opportunity for you to be able to give of your tithes and your offerings to the Lord. Can we say amen to that? Yeah, that's right. We need to do that because I shared a little bit about that just a few weeks ago, where we couple weeks ago, where we need to make sure we're giving of our tithes and offerings because it belongs to the Lord. Amen? And so are you guys ready to worship the Lord again this morning? Hallelujah. Let's all stand to our feet and let's get ready to just enter in. I don't want it to take a while for you to get there. I want you to just go running. Go running right into his presence. Just go running right towards his throne and just come sliding in, if you will, right before him and just say, God, I just worship you today. Because I'm so anxious to be in your presence. I'm so anxious to just let you know how awesome you are in my life. I just want you to know that you are a great God and worthy of all praise today. Hallelujah. Let's worship him today.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my you have been faithful. In all my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running out. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I'll sing of the goodness of God. I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God.
Will you just do that this morning? Will you just sing of His goodness in your life?
Oh, we sing of Your goodness, Lord. You've been so good to us. Been so good to us, Lord. You're worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for You. Oh, we live for You. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for You. Oh, we live for You, Lord, holy.
And I will.
trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in
See you. a love like no other.
Those words, lean back in the loving arms of a beautiful Father and breathe deep. Everybody, breathe deep. Breathe deep and know that He is good and He's got a love like no other. I love that. I hope y'all are breathing in today. His presence is here. He loves you so much. Do you feel His love today? Breathe in. Just take a deep breath. Just take a deep breath. He is so good. Some of you might say, what am I breathing? We're breathing in His goodness. He is so good. And He loves you so much. Wow. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your faithfulness to us. Lord, when we're not faithful, Lord, you are. We love you. We praise you because you are worthy. Father, we ask that you continue to be in our midst. Holy Spirit, we ask that you continue to be here, that you speak to us. Father, we want to walk out of this place having gained a nugget of truth from you that we didn't have when we walked in. Father, we need to hear from you today. And Father, we know that you are a faithful God and that you love us. And so we anticipate hearing something from you as we open our eyes, open our ears, open our hearts and our minds and our soul to hearing a personal truth from you. Father, I pray right now that nothing would come out of my mouth that you wouldn't have come out of my mouth. Lord, I know that I've prepared, but Father God, if you want to do something new, that's okay by me. Lord, I just want to know that it's you. And if I know it's you, I'll do whatever you want me to do, Father. So Father, have your way in this service. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, worship team. I love that song. I love our worship team. I love that they're led by the Spirit. So as most of y'all know, today is National WM Day. And I always will say this just for those new people that are here. National WM Day is something that is across the United States and even into the world. And they do this to give the ladies a spot at the pulpit. The WM National Office has a normally a WM theme for the year, and they normally have like a verse that goes along with it. And so a lot of times we get this information in, I'd say, November or December, and so I sort of look at it and be like, oh, what's the theme? Now I always anticipate that email, or I anticipate going to the website. And so sometimes I get their theme and it's like, oh, this is really exciting. I like this, you know. And then sometimes I sort of have an indifference to the theme. It's sort of like I don't have a feeling one way or another. You know how you can have a theme thrown at you. And then other years, and I was going back through my notes, and I seemed to see a pattern that sometimes this other year happens frequently, is that other thoughts hit me. And so that was what happened this year, was when I read the theme in December, it was sort of like all of a sudden I panicked. And the words intimidated me, and I had a lot of apprehension. And I was just sort of like, oh my God, I don't know how I'm going to be able to speak this word on WM Day. You know, and all I could think was, I'm glad now I don't go on feelings, right? Because those were my thoughts, was I don't know how I'm going to, you know. But God always has a plan, so I'm not going to keep you in suspense. But the WM theme this year is She Abides. And I was like, wow, She Abides. What an intense theme to speak on. Now, some of y'all are like, ah, what's the big deal? You know, but you're not up here preaching, are you? Right. So I will tell, as I do every year, we always go over how many pages is in my sermon. And of course, everybody guessed, you know, Jamie guessed 12. There is 14 pages, but who knows what God's going to do in these pages, right? And I will tell you that if you ever read my notes and then you go back and listen to the service, because I always listen to the sermon again, right? Because I don't ever know what I'm going to say. And so it's really interesting to see what is, I think, is going to be pertinent. And then all of a sudden it just doesn't make it up here. And then other things that I never even thought of in my wildest dreams come out of my mouth. So just be ready to hear whatever, right? So understand my apprehension about this theme, She Abides. I actually have a word that they're going to throw up here. Because you have to understand, I have a problem with certain concepts. And so unless you know that about me, and once you know it, you'll be like, oh, that's Janice, right? But some of y'all don't know that about me. So can we throw up the first word? Okay. Now, I know how to say this word in here, right? But everybody that knows me knows that it doesn't come out of here. And so even my friends like Sherry Kelly has corrected me throughout the years because I always say it wrong. Now, how do y'all say that word? Worcestershire. How do I say that word? Worcestershire. Don't know why, but that's how it comes out. So whenever I see that word, it's like instead of just reading it, I'm like, how do you say the word? Worcestershire. You know? But it's like it's there, but it's not here. So, you know, another thing is like electricity. I don't get electricity. Terry knows this. I just want the lights to turn on and to turn on. You don't want to ever ask me to fix anything because I don't understand it. I remember my dad, who was really good in all of that kind of stuff. I remember once in math, him like on a cardboard box drawing out this thing, and he's like, you get it? And I'm like, no, but I was scared to tell him no, I really didn't get it because what he was saying was foreign to me. I was like, I don't get it. Or nursing. We love nursing, those nurses of us, those that are nurses. But there are some things that just don't come naturally. Right? Like ventilation. Now, you guys are thinking ventilation like the vents. No, I'm talking about breathe in, breathe out, gas exchange, all of that. Or, and some of y'all that are not nurses won't even know what this means, but they are very important. What about potassium channel cells? They're very important, but if you ask me right now really what they did, I won't be able to tell you. I'd have to research it. Or the endocrine system. There are hormones that are produced that then produce other things that produce other things, and it's just like this chain reaction. Or I could even go, what about blood compatibility? You know, certain bloods are compatible to certain. Okay, so all I'm getting at is that there are things that, and y'all may now realize that you're a lot like me. Aren't you glad that I shared that with you? that you just might not get. And so when you hear something, all of a sudden there's some intimidation factor to there. And so that's what happened when I read this theme, She Abides, because it was like, abide, abide, abide. Ooh. Okay, now it's not that I don't have a relationship with the Lord. It was just that it was sort of this concept that sort of fell along the lines of Worcestershire or ventilation or calcium channel cells, you know. So in my initial panic attack, all I could think was, okay, God, you're faithful. And y'all have heard me say this several times. If you can speak out of a donkey, you can speak out of me. You are faithful. You are faithful. And then what did I do in December? I just sort of put it on the back burner. Because December was a great month for me. How many of y'all had a good month in December? Some of y'all. I mean, you know, we have months that are better than other months. But in December, in fact, I would say it was a fantastic time for me. You know, I mean, and I say fantastic time in that the Lord was speaking words to me. I mean, people were giving me words that said, God wants me to tell you X, Y, Z. Here's a scripture that God wants me to tell you. I mean, it was all over the place. I mean, you know, it was not just one. It was like multiples. I mean, I was just sort of, I mean, Terry and I had had discussions. I was just blown over with what God was going to do. And I was excited. And I thought, wow, everything is really peachy, and this is just awesome, because that's how you act when you're on the mountain, right? And then 2021 hit. Like, literally, it hit. And it didn't hit well. And I was just inundated with things the first couple weeks that just really brought me to my knees. And y'all may not have known, Terry was aware. It made me want to cry. I wanted to hide. I wanted to cry some more. I was hit with medical tests out of the blue that then, I had a medical test that then they were wanting follow-up medical tests. I had work stuff going on that made me nauseous and anxious. Then I had reactions to my COVID vaccine. You know, then I had family stuff going on that just had my heart aching. And then there was the tragedies inside the church, you know, losing Larry, that just filled our entire family with grief and sorrow. And I just remember thinking, and I remember telling Terry, I thought 2020 was supposed to be better than 20. 2021 was supposed to be better than 2020. I said, but man, this stinks. I don't know what I'm going to do to get through. And Terry heard it multiple times those first couple weeks, because I was broken. I mean, you guys probably didn't know it because, you know, I don't see y'all as much as I see him, right? But, I mean, I was like, it seemed like every time we got in the car, I'd be like, I mean, I'd just start crying, you know? And it was just one thing after another. And I just thought, I don't know how I'm going to do this. And all I can remember him saying was, you just need to snap out of it. Isn't that how your wonderful non-compassionate husband says things to you? You just need to step out of it. And all I could remember was, I don't know that I can. You know, it wasn't that I wasn't doing the right things, because we were fasting, we were praying, we were reading the Word, we were reading, you know, the Hal Donaldson book. I mean, you know, we were attending church, I was worshiping, I was doing all the things that should have not caused all of that stuff to sink in, right? And I didn't understand it. And then one day I did understand it, because it was like God spoke. But you know, sometimes God speaks, but he doesn't speak. Don't y'all love those times? Sometimes I like it when he speaks. Sometimes it's like, okay, just speak, but don't speak. But when I didn't get the theme, She Abides, in December, when it was that foreign concept, all of a sudden in January, when my circumstances were blowing up around me, God used those to make the theme sink in. She abides. He didn't just want me to get the word. He wanted me to have to live the word. Because during that time, when my husband was saying, get over it, Can I say it again? Well, my husband was saying, get over it. God was making it where I didn't have anybody to turn to but him. So today I'm going to share with you a few truths that hit home to me during those times and that were reinforced about abiding in Jesus. And so the text today, I'm going to have Emily come up and read because it's one of those tongue-twister texts. So she's an elementary school teacher. She can do it.
I can. Sure. Tongue-twisters. Okay. John 15, 1 through 11 says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself, unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers. And the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. By this, my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and so to prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full.
There's a lot of verses there, and there's a lot about branches and vines and fruits and branches and vines and lots of stuff there. In fact, it could put you in a tailspin if you read it. It was like Terry's passage last week. It was sort of like you want your eyes go round and round, and you're like, okay, I need to grasp what this is being said. Or I thought about Pastor Pete. I thought you could do an entire small group semester on this. Just this one hunk of scripture. But today I want to focus on three words in this whole set of scripture, and it's called abide in me. And so we're going to go back basic. We're going to go foundation level. We're going to dissect this thing. I'm not going to assume that you know anything, right? Because I don't know who's watching on Facebook. I don't know. You may be like me and want to say Worcester all the day long, right? So we're going to go back to the foundation, and we're going to go elementary style. So what does abide mean? Well, it's a verb, and it is active. And it means to remain or to stay, to continue in a particular condition, attitude, or relationship. Or, I found this definition and I really liked it, abiding in Christ is to intentionally remain in an ever-growing relationship with him that transforms our character to be more like his. Can I say that again? To intentionally remain in an ever-growing relationship with him that transforms our character to be more like his. Abide in me. Or, if we want to say what another translation said, and I loved this, to be intimately at home with me. To be intimately at home with me. So my message is three thoughts regarding this abiding in him. And I have letters to help you guys out. So number one is going to be the letter C, number two is going to be the letter D, and number three is going to be the letter P. And those are my 3 points, just to make it easy. C, D, P. Number one, we need to be connected with him. To truly abide with him or be intimately at home with him, we have to be connected with him. We have to know him, and we have to be known by him. We have to be united with him. So the first thing we have to assess in our life is, do I have a relationship with him? Because that's the starting point. That's the initial point. And so you have to, as a nurse, we do some things and we sort of assess. And so you have to assess, do I have a relationship with him, with Jesus? Do I know Jesus? Have I asked Jesus to be my Lord and Savior? The word says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God in Romans 3:23. And then it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him may have eternal life, John 3:16. And then it goes on and says, it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast, Ephesians 2:8 through 9. So our salvation is a gift that we have to receive. And that's the baseline. That's the baseline. That's the foundation we have to start with to be connected with Jesus. And we have to realize that it's a privilege that after this baseline, it's a privilege enough that we get to ask him in our heart. But then after that, it's a privilege that we're going to be able to build upon that. So it's not enough to just say a prayer saying, Jesus, come into my life. I mean, you know, unfortunately, the church has gotten there through this last century that it's just enough to just pray to ask Jesus in your life, and then you can go on and do whatever you want to do. And that's not the truth. The truth is that that's the starting point. The truth is that after that, you have the privilege to go further than that, and you have to connect with him. So let's talk about how to be connected with him, since that is my first point. In the fast-paced world we live in, there are a lot of distractions. Terry can tell you my iPad is my number one distraction at home. If I tell you any of the electronics are. You know, I one day at work just forgot my phone in the car. Holy smokes, I would have thought that I had left my arm in the car. I mean, that was like my all-consuming thought for like the first several hours. Was my phone's in the car. Is somebody going to text me? Right? Or I left my Apple Watch at home. And Terry can tell you, when I do that, automatically we're out of the subdivision. He's not going to turn around and go back and let me get my Apple Watch. But my thought is, oh, gosh, I've left my Apple Watch. You know, and so it's like you're connected to all of these things. Maybe some of y'all, it's video games. I think Pastor Corey plays video games, right? Yeah. So maybe you're connected to video games, or maybe it's hobbies, you know. I'm not going to throw out people, but, you know. But it's so good. Hobbies, you know, like, you know, working with wood. I mean, you love that. Or Brenda with knitting. You know, I know. Or gardening now. She's about to get into the gardening. So there's so many things we can be connected with. And what we have to make sure is that those connections are not stronger than our connection with him. It's so easy to be distracted and let those connections be stronger than the one that we need to have the most connection with. If you find that that's the case, then you just need to evaluate and say, Lord, is there something you need to show me here? So if we don't want to be connected to those things, then how are we going to be connected to him? Because I said we're going to go elementary here. So, you know, y'all are getting like a foundation class. One is we make conscious choices that honor Jesus in our speech and in our actions. Psalms 19:14 says, let my words and my thoughts be pleasing to you, Lord, because you are my mighty rock and my protector. Or Colossians 1:10 says, then you will live a life that honors the Lord, and you will always please him by doing good deeds. You will come to know God even better. Or we can think thoughts that honor Jesus. Because when we think the thoughts that honor him, our mind is all of a sudden in sync with his mind. Isn't that where we all want to be? So Romans 8:5 says, people who are ruled by their desires think only of themselves. Everyone who is ruled by the Holy Spirit thinks about spiritual things. How many of y'all want to be ruled by the Holy Spirit? I do. Or we can spend time with him through prayer, having a conversation with him, which is all prayer is. It's not that big of a concept. You know, it just, I think Satan would like to intimidate us with prayer so many times, especially new Christians. So I want to encourage you today, all prayer is just talking to him. If you're having a bad day, you say, man, it's a crummy day. If you're having a great day, Lord, thank you for what an awesome day. He knows anyway, so you might as well just have a conversation and let him know out of your mouth. So Matthew 6, 7, 8 says, when you pray, don't talk on and on as people do who don't know God. They think God likes to hear long prayers. Don't be like them. Your Father knows what you need even before you ask. Or 1 Thessalonians 5, 17, be unceasing and persistent in prayer. Or another way we can stay connected is to read and study his word, and dare I say, memorize his word. We older ones, memorization just doesn't come easy in the latter years. So young ones, I'm telling you now, memorize as much word as you can, because it doesn't get any easier than where y'all are at right now. Psalms 119:11, your word I have treasured and stored in my heart that I might not sin against you. Memorize his word. Read and study his word. Then we praise and worship him. Pastor Isaac just brings me to the throne room every Sunday. And I say Pastor Isaac, but it's Pastor Isaac letting the Holy Spirit lead him. Thank you, Pastor Isaac. So we praise and we worship him. Psalms 95:6, oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. Or Psalms 63:3-4, because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. In your name, I will lift up my hands. You know, there is freedom in lifting up your hands. If you've never done it, I'll never forget the first time I did it. I was scared to death. You know, you think that all of a sudden there's this huge spotlight. Spotlight! Right on you. She lifted her hands! You know? Okay, it's not that way. So just so y'all know, we don't have a spotlight, and it's okay. But there is a freedom that will come when you lift your hands and worship and give everything to him. We meditate. We have a quiet time. Psalms 104:34, may my meditation be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord. And the last one I want to mention, a way that we can connect with him, is we have fellowship with others who are in fellowship with him. The apostles were sent out by twos. I thought this was interesting because Jeremy said this Thursday, and I already had it in my notes, and I thought, okay, there's some reinforcement, Lord. The apostles were sent out by two. Jesus knew that they would need companionship and support as they walked their journey of faith. If you are not having fellowship with those that believe the same as you do, then it is going to be harder to stay connected with him. When we say, why do you need to be in church? Okay, it's not because Pastor Terry needs you as a number. It's not because we need a seat filler. It's because for the goodness of your soul, you need to be in fellowship with somebody else and to have somebody holding you accountable with this walk that we're walking on. Because if you rely just on yourself, the tendency is that Satan's going to skew things and Satan's going to throw all sorts of roadblocks in your way to keep you from being on this path. And I will say, just as a FYI, it does look like we will be doing a small group sometime soon on how to foster a quiet time in your life. Okay, back to my message. So one is we have to stay connected to him. Two is we have to have dependence in him. We owe everything to him, right? Thank you, Corey. We owe everything to him, correct? Thank you. We are nothing without him. And yet, why is it that all of a sudden we get the credit for everything we do? I got a raise. I got the job I wanted, you know? Whatever it is, I got a new car, you know? Why is it that we don't always give the credit to him? In the illustration that Emily read, it says, Jesus is the vine, and we are the branch. So we as the branch are dependent on Jesus as the vine. So that's how we get our nourishment, right? We're the branch, he's the vine. But Jesus is the vine, and so he's not dependent on the branch, correct? Correct. So why is it that we just think that we as the vine can, or we as the branch, can just go out there and do whatever we want to do? We can't, okay? So we need to realize we have a dependence on him. I would say in 2020, and I've heard a lot of people say this, and I think it's true, that it was a year that God wanted to allow COVID to make us more dependent on him. I know a lot of people had a lot of aspects of their lives that was totally disrupted, whether it was financially, physically, emotionally, psychologically, spiritually. But I want to say, however COVID disrupted your life, Jesus wants you to put your total dependence on him. Because unfortunately, even with COVID, it is so easy to look at other avenues and other people as a way of helping us through our circumstances. Whether it's the government, everybody say loving stimulus checks, right? Okay? Well, there's not anything wrong with saying you like your stimulus check, but are we giving God the credit for the extra funds and for helping us pay off our bills, helping us give our tithe, plug for tithe, help for giving extra permission, plug for missions, you know? Or what about your families, you know, if mom and dad are helping you pay a bill, or your church families when they give you meals, or help you watch the kids, or whatever church families do, because we know there's everybody's different ways in what we do. Or what about your friends or neighbors? I mean, what would we do without Lamar, right? You know? Or work. Hey, I got some bonus money at work last year because of COVID. I don't know if y'all did or not, but nurses, I think some of the hospitals gave a little bit of an extra bonus. Don't get me wrong. When I say you're fortunate if you have people and things that support you, but ultimately we have to look at the fact that God is the one. God is the one that we are dependent on. And when we want to turn to anybody else, instead of turning to God first, we need to reevaluate where our relationship is with him. Young kids, if y'all can learn, I say kids, that's because y'all are like kids to me. If y'all could learn that now, you know, don't just automatically, now, don't get me wrong, mom and dad love hearing from you. So don't get me wrong on this, okay? Because they really want you to talk to them about anything and everything. No subject off the table. But you need to be able to turn to God. Because at some point, mom and dad aren't going to be there for you. And you're going to need to be able to have a relationship with him that you can go to him and cry out your sorrows to ask him for things. Whatever it is. So you need to have that relationship with him. And then we need to also give him the credit because he is the one moving behind the scenes. That's why we say, thank you, Lord. I love this song. I'm going to share with you my favorite scripture. And it's Psalms 121. We're going through a lot of scripture today. So y'all may have to watch later and grab it. Or ask me for all my color-filled notes because there's so much highlighted and colored in here. It's pretty amazing. It's like a rainbow. Psalms 121, and it pertains to how we need to be dependent on him. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. We need our dependence to be on him because there is no safer place to be. I love my husband dearly. Everybody said amen. No. And I trust that he can protect me. But I know God can protect me. And he is the one I am dependent on more than anything. He is the physical tangibleness of God's love for me. Number 3, P. We need to press on with him. We need to chase him. We need to go deeper with him. We need to pursue him more feverishly. If Terry has said it once in our 35 years of marriage, he said it more than once. And he said a lot of things that I have liked and a lot of things I have not liked. But I'll never forget the conversation we had, and I probably was in my 20s, when he informed me that as a Christian, we never attain. Do you remember us having this discussion? It's probably one of many. As a Christian, we never attain. We're always pressing on to be more in Jesus. It's never good enough. Kids, it's never good enough. I know that that's depressing probably to hear, because at some point you think that it's going to be good enough, but it's not. Because with our relationship with him, we don't ever get to say, oh, we've arrived. Not until we're up in heaven. So you need to understand now, we have to press in with him. To press in, of course, assumes two things. One is that we're saved, right, and connected with him. And the other is we're dependent on him. So now we move on to pressing in on him, and we say, okay, James, I don't get the difference. Connected, dependence, pressing, what's the difference? And I really, you know, sort of was like, what do you want me to share about this? Pressing in, pressing in, pressing in. And this is what I got. Energy, sincerity, time, depth, passion, zeal, determination, and purpose. To press on with Jesus, you need to be doing all that you're doing to be connected to Jesus. But you've got to do it with more. You have to add these descriptive words, like making conscious choices that honor Jesus more eagerly. Thinking thoughts that honor Jesus with more sincerity and more regularity. Spending time with him through prayer with more depth. Reading and studying his word and memorizing his words with more dedication. Worshiping him more passionately. Meditating and having quiet times with more determination. Having fellowship with others who are in fellowship with God with more purpose, or more purposefully. 1 Peter 3:10 through 13 says, "For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good?" And we know that he is good. So when we are zealous for him, when we seek him, when we pursue and press on with him. So I want to go back to just what I was saying at the beginning about my struggles, those first couple weeks in 2021, because I really struggled with this. I was like, how can I go from, and it's not like I'm not, you know, I haven't lived this life being a Christian for a long time, right? But it still amazes you where you could go from the mountaintop and all of a sudden you're in the pits of despair. And if you've not been there, then I hope that you never are. But when you are there, just remember, say, this is what Janice was talking about, okay? Because this is something that the Lord wants me to share with you. So even though I was struggling with this concept of abiding, and then I was struggling with the first few weeks, there was a couple things that came to me. One is this statement, abiding is something that as Christians we experience as we grow in him. As we experience challenges, and as we grow in Christ, we can abide with him on deeper levels. Y'all want me to read that again? In the scripture that Emily read earlier, it says that each branch that bears fruit, he prunes so it will bear more fruit. Pruning means cutting. So the scripture, in essence, says that we as Christians, the ones who love and are loved by Jesus, the ones who are connected with him, dependent upon him, pressing in with him, that we're going to be specifically cut. And the truth of that is, cutting hurts. So you might say, Janice, are you saying that those situations that were hurtful was because you were going through pruning? And I would say, absolutely. Painfully divine moments in our lives are occurring when we're pruned so that he can make us more holy and more fruitful. It's hard to look at painful moments. It's hard to be pruned. Nobody says, prune me, I'm ready. We as nurses would say, you can prune me if you give me some anesthesia and some pain meds on the backside of the pruning. Because pruning is ugly sometimes. Pruning isn't pretty. Pruning is ugly. But I want you to take comfort in that the one who is pruning you during those times, he's the master pruner. He knows what he's doing. You may not like it, but there will come a time that you will like it. I could say as a pastor's wife, ministry is a good time to be pruning. But I wouldn't change it for anything. And you don't have to be a pastor's wife. Just walk in the Christian road. You need to expect that there's going to be pruning. And you'd like to say, when the pruning comes, that you're going to recognize it for what it is. Okay, Lord, this is pruning. I can be so happy knowing that I'm being pruned right now. But unfortunately, it doesn't come like that. Maybe on occasion you might notice that you're being pruned. But sometimes you are like I was in January when I was telling Terry, I don't know how I'm going to get through this. I'm thankful, sort of, that he didn't say to me, it's okay, honey, you're being pruned. Don't ever say that to me. That would be too spiritual in that moment. You can write a note and leave it, or say, the Lord gave me a verse for you, but just don't throw that out there. Just saying. Husbands, I would not suggest you do that to your wife unless God really tells you to say that. So for those of you today that are pruning, being pruned, it's going to be okay. Pruning doesn't last a whole lifetime. It's for a season. And he's pruning you because he sees something in you that is worth pruning. He sees the fruit on the other side of the pruning. And what an amazing fruit it's going to be. Our job in there is just not to lose it during the time of pruning. And how do we not lose it? Just from what I shared with you this morning. Connecting with him. Depending on him like your life depends on it during the pruning time. Everything that I went through in January wasn't like I was walking back on my faith. God knew I was just being real with him, you know, and he knew what he was doing. I just didn't at the time. And we need to press in with him. If you're not pressing in enough with him, then today's your day that he wants to hear you hear him say, hey, the pressing, you've laid off on the pressing, it's time to press in again. I just want everybody to close their eyes for a minute, and I just want you to allow me a little bit of honesty. I'm going to ask for shows of hands here, and nobody's looking but me. But I really want to pray with some people this morning. I'm going to ask a couple different questions, and, you know, at the end, I'll be like, if that's you, raise your hand, and you guys can raise your hand, because I just want to, and just keep it raised just enough so I can glance across the auditorium, but everybody with their eyes closed. First of all, for those that you're not sure you have a relationship with Jesus, are you even out of the starting gate on this journey to abide with him? Are you intimately at home with Jesus? Have you asked Jesus for forgiveness and to be your Lord and Savior and to come and to live inside of you? If not, I want to tell you today's the day that you can start that journey. And so if that is you, I just want you to raise your hand. Okay. The second one is, for those of you that have asked Jesus in your heart, and you know you're abiding in him, and you know you're abiding because the scripture makes it clear that you're showing fruit. But maybe you're not seeing the fruit that you want to see. Because maybe you're connected and doing things with other things, and so maybe your fruit is not as fruitful as you would like. So if you aren't seeing the fruit you want to see in your life, would you raise your hand? And lastly, I want to pray for those that are abiding, but currently you're in a pruning stage. And the cutting, it's intense. And you're not sure if you can make it. Would you raise your hand, because I want to pray with you. Thank you. Thank you. Father, you saw all of these hands that went up in the sanctuary today. And Lord, I don't even know what's going on Facebook and what's going to continue to be on Facebook as this video is played, Father God. But Lord, you do. And Father, I pray right now for every single person that needs to know you as their personal Savior. Lord, I ask right now that you would come in as they say, Lord, forgive me. Come into my life. I ask you to come into my life and to make me a new creature in you. Father God, I ask that you would just honor that as they say that, Lord, and that you would just come in and make them a new creation so that they can start this walk, so that they can start to learn how to abide in you. For that is your desire, Lord. For those that are just not seeing the fruit that they want to see, Father God. Maybe there's fruit there, but Father God, they know that there needs to be so much more fruit. Their actions, Father God, aren't showing what's in their heart that they know is in there, Father God. It's showing what is just, Lord, you know. I don't even want to go there because, Lord, I know. Father, you know their relationship with you. And you know that their hearts today are just crying, Lord, make my fruit be good fruit. Father, I ask that your Holy Spirit would convict them to show those areas in their life, Father God, that they need to turn over to you more fully so that they can bear that fruit that they desire to bear. And that, Lord, you will be the one that will make that happen, Father. Because we can't do it in ourselves, Father. It has to be you. And for those, thirdly, that are in a pruning time, Father God, Lord, I've been there just recently. Oh, God, give them grace during this time. Give them your presence during this time. When Satan comes in with his ugly words and his flood of lies, Father God, let them see the truth that they are in a pruning time. And that they're going to come outside on the other side to having an abundance of fruit. Not so that they can say that they have fruit, but Father, for your kingdom's sake, they're going to have fruit. And Lord, that fruit is going to be testimonies and testimonies and testimonies of your goodness and your grace and your mercy. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to be able to speak what was on your heart today, Father. I thank you that you trust me, Lord. You trust me to just stand up here and to be real, but to give it all to you, Lord, because without you, I have nothing. Without you, I am nothing. Father, we love you. We ask that you would be with us today. Lord, let all of our hearts be to bear fruit, to be in your presence, to know you more fully. In Jesus' name, amen.
She makes me look good. Of course, she has let you know I'm not the best counselor in the world. But anyway, other than that, hallelujah. What a word. Get connected to God. If you're struggling in an area, if you're you're going through things and you don't know what, get connected to God. Become dependent upon him. More dependent. Let go of your ability to do and depend on him. And then press in. Press in with him. Whatever stage or whatever level you are in that walk with him, wherever you are in that struggle in life, we all struggle from time to time. And sometimes we have to go back and get more connected. Sometimes we have to go back and get more dependent. Sometimes we have to just press in a little bit more. And we go through cycles and times, but we all are on this walk together. And so I encourage you, take these words that God has just been speaking through Janice today of just connect, depend, and press in. And he will be right there with you because his word says this. He says, draw near to me, and I will draw near to you. It's a fact. Whenever we reach out to connect, he's going to be right there reaching back out towards us immediately to connect with us. Whenever we become dependent upon him, he shows himself faithful. And whenever we press in, he's right there with us in every bit of it. So let's just trust him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What a great day we've had in the house of the Lord this morning. I pray that you will come back this evening for our annual business meeting at 5 o'clock for the dinner and then the meeting close to around 6. We do have the annual business reports. They're going to be handed out to you as you leave today. Please take those home, review them, look through them. If you have questions, make notes in there, mark them down, write them down. We want to answer all your questions. We want you to know what God has been doing with the finances of this church and just throughout everything that goes on here at Grace Point. We want you to be a part of that. So please pick up your packet on the way out today and bring it back with you tonight, okay, so that you'll have it as we review things tonight in the meeting. And Janice wants me to let you know that she has a special gift for all the ladies today that have been in attendance. So as you're leaving today, there'll be ladies out there handing out candles to each one of you. And so thank you for being here today. Let's all stand and just close in a word of prayer today. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this word that you have just given us today. Lord, let us get connected and stay dependent and press in even more than ever before to you, O God. Father, I thank you for this word. I thank you for my wife, Lord. I thank you for her heart and her willingness to share and to give herself completely to you and to your service. Now, Father, I pray for each one of the ladies of this church, Lord God, our women's ministries, Lord God, as they minister in so many different ways, Lord God, that many don't even get recognition for, but Lord, you know You see them. You know what they're doing. And God, I just pray your blessing upon each one of our ladies today. Now, as we go, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here this morning. See you tonight. Mm-hmm.